Dear friends in Christ, for today's sermon, I would like to give a little review of the season of Lent. We should ask ourselves, why is it that we have this holy season? And we can even ask ourselves another question. Well, who started Lent to begin with? Well, we know that the holy season of Lent goes all the way back to the time of the apostles. The apostles themselves were the ones who established this penitential season to prepare for the greatest feast in the liturgy of the Church, the Feast of the Resurrection, the Feast of Easter. And as we read in Scripture, we know that if there were no resurrection, our faith would be in vain. And so it is that the Church and the Apostles wanted Catholics to have this time set apart, these 40 days of preparation for the greatest feast in the entire Church year. We might ask ourselves also, why is it that it's 40 days? Well, the number 40 is a very mystic number in Scripture. We see it repeated quite often. In the Old Testament, we see Noah and the Ark. And we know that God was going to punish the world by a great flood. And so Noah was commanded by God to build this Ark. And we know that after Noah built this Ark and followed the rest of God's commands in putting two of every creature upon this ark, that God punished the world by a great flood, and it rained for 40 days and 40 nights non-stop. We also see the Israelites, the chosen people at the time, how they were held in captivity by the Egyptians and for over 400 years. And God raised Moses to lead the chosen people out of Egypt. And we know how God sent the 10 plagues, and upon the last plague, that the Pharaoh finally let the chosen people go, and after he let them go, he changed his mind and sent his soldiers after them. And we know that God, at this time, worked a great miracle, the parting of the Red Sea. And the Israelites were able to go through this, through the Red Sea to escape the Egyptian soldiers. But we know that the Israelites wandered in the desert in search of the chosen land for 40 years, the number 40. We also see Moses on Mount Sinai. Before Moses received the Ten Commandments from Almighty God, he went up into the mountain and prayed and was in close union with God for 40 days before he received the Ten Commandments. And then finally, in today's Gospel, we have our Divine Lord, Jesus Christ himself, who fasted and prayed in the desert for 40 days. And so it is that in imitation of our Divine Lord, we do penance for 40 days and 40 nights. We fast and we pray in imitation of our Divine Lord, as we see in today's Gospel. And just a quick review of the laws of the Church when it comes to fasting. We know that those who are 21 to 59 are bound to observe the laws of fast. And that means that we cut back on what we eat. We have one main meal, and we have two smaller snacks that together, these two smaller snacks cannot equal a main meal. Obviously, we're not bound to fast on Sundays, but we should remind ourselves that it's these two smaller snacks, one main meal, and meat is allowed at the main meal, except on Fridays. And I just have to give you, or tell you, a very humorous little story that the bishop recently told. But one of the sisters just recently turned 21, and so she was very worried, very concerned about this fasting thing that she had to do during Lent. And she wasn't quite sure about it, so she went to the bishop. She was a little uneasy. She said, "I'm just not sure about this whole fasting thing." The bishop said, "Don't worry, it's really easy. This is what you gotta do. It's very simple, keep it simple." He said, "You have one peanut for breakfast, you have another peanut for lunch, then you have two peanuts for supper. Easy, and there's nothing to worry about then." And the sister just was aghast, and she said, "If I had to survive on 4 peanuts a day, I'm going to die." And she said, "No, just trying to get the point across." But as we think about it, it's just a reminder to us that this fasting during this time is a very beneficial thing for us as Catholics. And we should obviously abide by the rules of Holy Mother of the Church when it comes to this matter. And unless we have a dispensation, we are bound to the laws of fasting during this time of Lent. And as I will be giving you ashes after Mass this afternoon, We are reminded that the ashes are a sign of penance as well. We read in the Old Testament about the Ninevites and how Jonas the prophet was told by Almighty God to go into Nineveh and to tell the Ninevites that he was going to destroy them because he was very displeased with their sinful lives. And we know in the Old Testament how Jonas fled from God, and he did not fulfill right away the command that was given to him. And it was during this time that he was shipwrecked, and how he was swallowed by a whale, and he was in the belly of a whale for 3 days and three nights. And after he was delivered from this, he realized he needed to do what God had commanded him. So it is that he went into Nineveh, and he told the Ninevites that God was going to chastise and destroy them because of their sinfulness. But what did the Ninevites do? They took Jonas's message very much to heart, and they put on sackcloth and ashes, and they did great penance for their sins. And God spared them because of the penance and the prayer that they offered in reparation for their sins. And so it is that the ashes that we receive remind us of that, that we need to take to heart the message that God has given to us of repentance and of penance during this holy season. And as we think about it, we are reminded that Christ himself did this, and it's just 40 days that will go by very quickly. I recently came across a saint that I was not very familiar with. This was Saint Francis of Paola. Some of you may have heard of him, but Saint Francis of Paola was a wonder worker. He worked many miracles throughout his life. One of the more famous miracles that he worked, he was denied passage on a boat once, and so it is that he just took his cloak off, laid it on the water, got into his cloak, and sailed across the lake in some place in Italy. But St. Francis of Paola also founded a religious order known as the Hermits of St. Francis. And the Hermits of St. Francis were a very penitential order. And they were very much very, very severe, very strict. But they were nicknamed the Minims. And they were nicknamed this because they were to be considered the least of all the religious. And they were of all the religious orders, and they were to live on the bare minimum, on the bare necessities. So it is that they practiced, so to say, a perpetual Lent. They perpetually abstained from all meat. They perpetually abstained from all dairy products, from eggs, from cheese, from milk, etc. And they lived a very severe lifestyle. Now, you know that there are certain saints that we have in the church that are very much to be inspired by, but not necessarily trying to imitate them. Now, I would say St. Francis is one of those saints. We should be inspired by his life, but we're not called to imitate him in his severity, in his rigorism. But God had raised St. Francis and his order in that particular time because the whole practice of Lent had become very lax. And Catholics were not taking Lent seriously at the time, so it is that God had called St. Francis to show to the world and to Christianity that we needed to go back to the practice of the season of Lent. And Pope Benedict XIV in the 1700s wrote a very beautiful encyclical on the season of Lent titled Non Ambiguous. But in this encyclical, he wrote very beautifully about how the season of Lent is the Christian badge of warfare. It's like it's the soldier's badge that he wears when he goes into battle. And how important it is that the season of Lent is observed by Christendom. And he was writing how he went on to say that when the season of Lent would become, or the observance of it would become lax, that it would be a very great detriment to mankind, society, and to Almighty God, because he would not be given what he desires of us. And so it is that we think about in our own day how in the Novus Ordo, the season of Lent has become something very, very lax. They are not bound by the same laws that we are bound by. They have very much loosened those. They, if I'm not mistaken, they're not bound under pain of sin to the fast. They're encouraged to abstain from meat on Fridays. Not like they absolutely have to. I believe they only have to abstain on Ash Wednesday and Good Friday. So it has become very lax in the modern church. So for us as traditional Catholics, it's important that we really take the laws of the Church to heart and that we follow them and try not to make excuses. It's very contrary to our nature. It's very difficult, yes. It's not an easy time, but it's a very grace-filled time. There's so many graces during this holy season that are to be had and found, and that God sheds upon us as we do this time of penance, of fast and prayer. Such a very, very beautiful time, and we shouldn't let it slip through our hands. It's going to go by very quickly, and it's not like we have to do it like St. Francis did in perpetual Lent. It's just 40 short days that will go by very, very quickly. And our Lord himself shows us today in the Gospel how he himself went through temptations. And I find this to be very encouraging, because all of us suffer temptations. All of us are attacked one way or another. And so it is that we shouldn't get discouraged when temptations are sent our way. And as we read in the book of Job, just as the life of man upon this earth is a continual warfare. We also read in Scripture, just as gold is tried by fire, so is man tried by temptation. And so it is that it shouldn't be a surprise or a shock to us, I'm being tempted. Or if a temptation should be very strong, it shouldn't get us discouraged, shouldn't get us down. Our Lord himself permitted himself and subjected himself to be tempted so as to show us how to overcome temptations. And it's very interesting. He wasn't tempted once or twice. He was tempted three times. And I find that very significant, because we have three main enemies of our soul. We have the world, the flesh, and the devil that we have to battle with. So it is in each of these three temptations that kind of show how it was temptation from the devil, temptation from the world, temptation from the flesh, from hunger. And so it is that he was like unto us in all things except for sin. And like I said, a very encouraging thing for us. And as we have begun this holy season of Lent, it is my sincere prayer that each and every one of us has a very graceful and a holy Lenten season, and that we use this time well. And remember, don't get grumpy, don't bite off anyone's head because you've given up coffee or those sweets or this or that. Don't become irritated or angry. Remember, we started off, or we had the Epistle on Charity last Sunday as a preparation for Lent, because it's a reminder to us, charity is really important. We can't let these crosses that we undertake, or these penances that we undertake during the season of Lent, we can't let those things overshadow the charity that needs to be had. Charity, as we read last Sunday, is patient, is kind, is not self-seeking, is not puffed up. And it's really important that we said that you can work miracles and move mountains and speak in tongues and prophesy. But yet, if you do all these things yet lack in charity, it profits you absolutely nothing. So it is, we can do all these penances and all these sacrifices and this fast during the season of Lent, but if we don't have charity, it's not going to profit us anything. So it's really important that we keep that in mind as we go through the season of Lent, that charity is very important. That as we undertake these penances, not easy, yes, it's contrary to our fallen human nature, but we have to have that spirit of love, that we're doing this for the love of God. Christ has died on the cross for the love of us. He has done so much more for us, and this is just a little thing that we can do in return for the great love and the great sacrifices that our divine Lord has worked for us and has shown us by his sufferings and his death on the cross. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen.